car paint scratch removal, scratch repair. And let's see what I can teach you today, but with the understanding that it is a very complex subject with many variables. Polishers, the types of polishers, the types of polishes, the types of compounds, wet sanding, different grits of sandpaper, touch-up paint. It is an area or a topic of detailing that gets complex very quickly. But let's see what I can teach you today, whether it's a do-it-yourselfer or a professional detailer that's looking to broaden their skill set. So let's have a look at the two scratches that I will be dealing with. Now I realize this is not in HD, but we have a scratch right here. So the first starting point is what most detailers call the fingernail test. So if the scratch is literally right here, if I go against the grain of the scratch, this would be the grain since the scratch is this way, can I catch an edge with my fingernail? Now the question is I can catch a slight edge right here. And trust me, because clear coat is so thin, and as a foundational rule that you need to understand, this is what's called a two-stage paint. That means you have the base color coat, in this case it's a charcoal gray, and then you have the top coat, which is a clear coat. Essentially, that's like an unpigmented paint coat. And clear coat, just so you know, is a type of plastic, a form of plastic. Now, plastics come in endless variations, endless formulations, just like virtually any other material, rubber, cloth, go down the list. Clear coat is one of them. So it's a type of plastic. The clear coat is the only material you really have to work with, because once you sand through or polish through the clear coat, it will change the color of the base coat. So if you go that far or that deep, you are screwed, and not in a good way. So you have to finesse these scratches. So that is the starting point, is can you catch an edge of a nail? So if you're looking to do yourself, that's a huge indicator. If you're looking to hire out a professional like myself, this is where you start. Before you call me, you see if you can catch an edge with your nail. Now, trust me, it does not take much. You have to think about how thick your actual fingernail is. Clear coat is thinner than your fingernail. By far, it is thinner than your fingernail. So there's not a whole lot of material to work with. Here is the second scratch that you can subtly see here, which I don't know if it's even gonna show up on the film. And the scratch basically goes like this. It's not even. And I go along the edge, and I can, in fact, feel an edge, especially right through here, the middle. And this is what's interesting about doing this type of repairs, is not only is every scratch unique, but the scratch itself, based on the length of the scratch, the entire scratch will be unique from every point of the way. So typically on the ends of the scratch, it may be thinner in depth or not as deep as it will be in the middle. So you not only have to dissect the panel itself and how you're going to be able to tape it off, sand it, polish it, whatever you're going to do, but you have to dissect the scratch itself. So it may be ultra thin here where you can barely feel it, and you know that a buffer itself could have removed that. But then through here to the middle where there's a edge to it, I'm gonna have to wet sand it. So you have to finesse it, you have to strategize, you have to break it down and dissect it and come up with a strategy that is appropriate for the type of scratch, the depth of it, the severity of it, go down the list. So I've got these two places that I'm gonna be dealing with. Now also, when it comes to touch-up paint, because a lot of people have misconceptions as to touch-up paint or this process. They think that I'm gonna show up with an airbrush and I'm just going to airbrush this in and it will blend perfectly and you'll never be able to see it. Well, that's not my skill set. Do they have guys that can do that? Yes, but as a rule, it is a temporary fix, because wherever they airbrush it and blend it, those blend marks or that blend area will wear differently, and over the course of time, you will start to see that area where they blended it. So to do this 100%, what a body shop would do if you wanted absolute perfection. Now I think because this is not that deep and I should be able to wet sand it virtually 99% away and then polish it to perfection. If you were to take this to a body shop, what they would do is they would literally sand this. They would feather in the edges so that it was perfectly smooth. Now if they went through the clear coat, they would then have to apply the color coat and pick some point of entry, some point of demarcation that is called. So maybe they would tape off this and they would use this line and tape that off and then use this fender line and they would spray the color coat through here and then they would apply clear coat over that and they would then blend the clear coat into the surrounding areas. That's what a body shop could do, or many of them would do. Some body shops would choose to do this whole panel so that there would be no blend marks whatsoever going down the future as it fades and degrades at different rates. Now, if you're thinking that you could apply touch-up paint, like the kind you get at the dealership, and just simply apply paint over it, well, guess what? Now you're putting touch-up paint on top of the surface. Two things are wrong with that. A, the touch-up paint will never match perfectly with this paint. Even if it's ultra, ultra close, what happens is you're applying touch-up paint on top of a flat surface, and it will create a raised area. By nature, or naturally, what will happen is because it's raised, it will cast a shadow. You see my finger and how it's casting a shadow? Now this is kind of an absurdity to use my finger because it's so thick, but it still happens with the subtle form of touch-up paint. It will cast a shadow, you will be able to see it. So in essence, what you're doing is you're trading off one problem for a different problem. And sometimes trading off with that different problem actually is better, but it's only slightly better. It's kind of like saying, do you want to get kicked in the left knee or the right knee? Well, ultimately they still hurt and it still sucks. And you don't really know which one really is better. And that's why sometimes as a professional, you have to really finesse it, try different strategies. But in this case, because there's no actual groove where the scratch is deep enough or wide enough to accept or receive touch-up paint into it, you cannot use touch-up paint in this situation. And that, my friends, is a video for a whole nother time. In this moment, I'm going to use wet sanding and polishing. Here is my setup, and I've got my new Milwaukee cordless. Yes, cordless, folks. Runs on an 18-volt battery. Milwaukee reached out to me. If you follow me on Instagram, you've been seeing some of my posts. This tool is amazing. It is ultra light. It is ultra powerful. The only drawback is battery life. But you could say that with anything, whether it's your electric car or electric drill motor, go down the list. But because it comes with, or you can get it with, two batteries, for me in my world, like in this situation, I will barely go through a single battery fixing these two scratches. I've got my different polishes and compounds. I got my foam pad that I will be following up with the rotary, but I will be doing everything with the rotary. This is my little wet sanding kit. I've got different grades of sandpaper starting at 800, goes to 1500, goes to 2000, and then I've got my 3000 grit sanding disc here that I'll finish with. I even have my rack attack. Yes, talk about saving the back and the knees, especially when I'm working at this level, which I will be today. Now, here's a question or a proposition to put at you. When you're in the auto body world, which is vastly different than the detailing world, and those are two worlds that really do not understand each other. I've dealt with many, many body shops, and they cannot wrap their mind around the fact that us professional detailers can spend so much time and get paid so much money to do high-end, high-level paint correction. They don't get it because they are forced and are constrained by the insurance companies. You think that they're working for the end customer, but really they are controlled and dominated by the insurance company. That's who their customer really is. And it's all about speed. So if a guy behind a buffer cannot sand and finish a single panel in like 2.5 minutes, guess what that guy is not doing? He's not working at that auto body. It is all about speed. Nothing will replace the rotary polisher for speed and efficiency that way. Now, if you're trained significantly enough, you can finish it to perfection even on black paint. Very few guys are trained to that level, especially in the auto body world, because the consumer is rather ignorant. They do not have a trained eye, and therefore they can get away with it. And in all honesty, the auto body world considers DA polishers as toys. Why? Because they're so slow compared to a rotary. You will never see a DA polisher in a high volume production shop. And by high volume, I mean they're doing 600,000 to 700,000 per month. They're delivering 30, 40 cars per day. Imagine the volume of that. So if you think that they're gonna bust out a DA and spend 4, 5, 6 times as long as needed as compared to a rotary to make it all perfect and a level 10, it just ain't gonna happen, folks. So seriously, the auto body world considers DA polishers as toys, as children's toys. So, and me personally, I use both. They both serve a purpose in my world as a professional detailer, and I highly recommend that you get trained on a rotary because it can save you a boatload of time and effort. Yes, it requires a unique skill set, but it is worth the investment to get a quality rotary and to get trained by someone that knows what they're doing. Once again, because this is not HD, I'm not gonna worry about zooming in, but the scratch is right here. I've got my 1500 grit sandpaper. I'm not gonna make a big fat mess and try to water this down with a hose. I can simply use, and this is Chemical Guys EcoSmart, ready to use their waterless detailing system. The key with using sandpaper is to keep it wet. And the reason you wanna keep it wet is because it allows all the dirt and debris that you're sanding away and keeps your paper clean. So ideally, if I was doing a whole section, I would have a constant flow of water. So that is the key to damage control. Now I'm going to allow the paper to do its job, which means I'm not going to apply a lot of pressure to this. I'm going to just barely pressure, just enough where I can feel the sandpaper is biting into that material, the clear coat, and beginning to sand. And this is 1500 grit, as I said. I will then progress to 2000 grit and then 3000 grit. And at 3000 grit, you can pretty much polish it out by hand. I will be using a polisher, but 3000 grit is so fine that you can do it by hand. So long that you have the understanding that you're actually using a polish or a compound that has some actual abrasives to it. That is key. It needs some abrasives. Now there's lots of polishes out there, Meguiar's, Mother's, go down the list, and they call it scratch remover. But really, because it's been dumbed down so much to make it ultra safe for the average Johnny consumer, that there's no true abrasives to it. It's a chemical, what's called a chemical cleaner. And you can rub and rub and rub, and it's really just going to be, it's gonna prove to be rather ineffective, put it that way. And I get so many questions thrown at me when it comes to polishing and buffers, and what's the best, Darren? What should I use? What's the best compound? Blah, blah, blah. How much should I rub? How much should I polish? Well, the reality is that you control all the variables, and you have the ability through different grades of sandpaper, different types of buffers, different types of speed, pressure, polishing pads, go down the list. So you can literally pick and choose your way to success. So, and largely this is where experience comes in, and it's hard to teach someone experience
literally through video format. Even in person, you can have a better chance at teaching them. So I'm not sure how much you're gonna actually be able to learn and pick up from this. Hopefully there'll be a few little nuggets of wisdom that you can take away from the moment. But you get to finesse it. And by finessing, this is what I mean, is you pick the sandpaper. So let's say you don't know how to use a rotary. And a rotary, I could now stop right now with a rotary polisher and 1500 grit, and I could remove those sanding marks and it would be perfect. It would just take me a little bit longer because it's 1500 grit. But I would rather sand than polish, because sanding is quicker than polishing. So I'm just gonna go through the three different layers of sanding paper so that the very end, when I polish this with the buffer, it will be ultra quick. So if you don't have access to the buffer, but you have access to those types of sandpaper, well, guess what? You could take it down to even 5,000 grit and you could do it all by hand. And that's assuming that it is a scratch that can be literally sanded away completely. And once again, that's a whole nother topic, because you may find that the scratch is in fact all the way through the clear coat, and therefore any of us are limited regardless of our skill set, regardless of our tools and products that we have at our disposal. The point I was trying to make is that you can dictate the moment. So if you have a DA polisher, yes, maybe it will take you longer to remove these scratch marks, but you can still do it. So you pick a more firm pad, what's called a cutting pad. You pick a more aggressive compound or polish, and you start there. Maybe you apply a little more pressure with your hand. Maybe you dial up the speed a little bit more. So that's what I say, is you are in a large way in very much control of the moment, knowing that everyone still has limitations to the moment. Now, there will be very few limitations to this moment because of my experience and the vast assortment of tools and products and sandpaper that I have. The other side, because I could feel that edge with my fingernail more than this, I know that the other scratch that I'll be showing you will be more problematic. I may not be able to remove that 100%, but I sure as heck know that I will be able to diminish it to the point where it will literally be undiscernible by virtually anyone, unless Johnny Customer decides to point it out to someone. And then they would even have to get in the right lighting, view it from the right angle in order to even pick it up with the unaided eye. And you'll notice that I have my cheater glasses on. This is literally like a magnifying glass that I put on so that I can magnify what I'm working on. And this is very effective, by the way, because I know that if I can get it at a magnified level, when I take these off and look at it under normal viewing conditions, then chances are it's gonna be absolute perfection. So what I'm checking for is, and because this is so easy to wipe off, it's such a small area, what I'm checking for, and I'm looking in different lighting and I can still see the subtle line, even though I've sanded it, it will reveal itself because now I've created a satin finish compared to the glossy finish of the untouched paint area. I can still see a subtle line of the scratch, so I know that I need to take this a little further. Now, I don't want to take it all the way down, because right now I'm dealing with two things in my mind. One is I know that I only have a limited amount of clear coat to work with. Now, I'm not going to bust out my clear coat or my paint gauge thickness tool, because I have enough experience. I know essentially how thick most stock paint is, and also I don't want to remove it down to the absolute bare minimum, because the clear coat is actually what gives your paint its UV protection from fading. So I will want to retain as much of this, and that's where you have to find that winning balance between you and your customer. But your customer can only help you find that by them being educated. Most consumers, as in car owners, don't understand that. Never mind, most detailers don't understand that. So we become all fixated as detailers of doing high-level paint correction, not really understanding that the more we polish on that surface, the more clear coat we remove, the more thinner we are going to make that clear coat, and therefore we diminish, the more we polish that UV, that natural UV protection. That's kind of that one of those dirty little secrets that very few people in the industry even ever talk about, but it is in fact a reality. So what I want to do is I want to take this down, do the main cutting with this, and get to the point where I know that I still have room to sand with the sandpaper, and then follow up with polishing, and know that I'll still have clear coat intact, but I want to do it so I still have room to finish off with my other sandpaper, my follow-up sandpapers. So what I'm doing is I'm creating what's called a uniform scratch pattern at the depth of 1500 grit. So that's what I'm trying to do. And I'm literally trying to sand to the bottom, virtually to the bottom of that scratch. Then what I do is I come back through with my 2000 grit, and then I create a new, more shallow uniform scratch pattern at 2000 grit. Then I follow up with 3000 grit and create a uniformed scratch pattern with 3000 grit. Then I come in with my buffer and my compound, and that's when I can remove it and polish it to perfection. So this is what I'm doing. Now you could go back and forth, up and down, circular. Honestly, it does not matter, because really the goal is to remove the scratch and to remove your sanding marks. So if you are polishing enough and sanding enough, you could create any pattern you want, because if you sand with 3000 grit, you would need a microscope to be able to determine if you did not remove the sanding marks 100% with your polisher and compounds. You would need a microscope to be able to tell what type of pattern you went into, whether it's side to side, up and down, circular. So with the unaided eye, it just becomes irrelevant. Now I'm going to graduate to 2000 grit, and this is called wet and dry. As a rule, it's used wet because the water allows the spent material that you're sanding away to wash away, but that would require running water. I really am using water in this moment as purely a lubricant, and so it doesn't gum up my sanding paper completely. And like I said, this is where efficiency comes in. I don't really need to bust out a hose and go through all that big mess and make a big mess on this car to do a little scratch like this. This is also where that cordless rotary comes in. I don't even need an electrical outlet to plug in my traditional corded buffers with, because I've got my rotary. And because I can take a rotary, or I can take the paint and finish to 100% hologram free with the rotary, that makes me even more effective and efficient. So you think saving 5 minutes here, 5 minutes there is like just probably trivial in your world, but that's where profitability comes in. You start adding up all those 5 minutes here and 5 minutes there on every job, and suddenly on a single job, it can be 10 minutes, 15, 20 minutes, and you times that by X amount of jobs per day, and suddenly all those little 5 minute moments could add up to 30 minutes, 60 minutes of your time. And once again, if you accept time really is money, then you are wasting money. You are not being as profitable as you can be. But hey, if that works for you in your world, as I say, go with it. I just know in my world, I want to be as efficient, as effective, and as profitable as I possibly can. To me, that is a win for both parties. So there I have 2000, created a uniform scratch pattern with 2000. Now this is a disc, it's meant to go on some type of pneumatic or electrical, whatever you want. I use it often by hand. It is a very expensive, it's Sia Karat. I think that's how you pronounce that last name. So, but I can use it by hand, and it's 3000 grit. Now this will outlast, I mean, it really just is a superior sanding disc. Far more superior than you're gonna find on any shelves of even auto body shops. You would have a hard time finding this stuff. But boy, is it worth every cent. I think you get a package. One package is like anywhere from, I think it's like $24. So one of these discs would equate to about $12 to $14, if I recall. It's been a while since I've bought any of them, but they last so much longer. And so to me, once again, time is money. If I can sand out, you know, like five panels instead of one panel, to me, it's way worth it. So there we have. And now I can see that it's just all sanded down. I see no marks. I'm gonna do a little more right through here. And this is the power. Literally and figuratively speaking, the power of these reader glasses is it truly magnifies the area to a point where the unaided eye would never be able to see this stuff. So that's my goal in over delivering, is to magnify the area, and that way I can have absolute perfection when I'm done. I've got my rotary with a wool pad. The wool pad is the most aggressive. And as far as wool pads go, I prefer a 100% wool pad versus the synthetic blends. Notice I have this taped off for protection because these edges are prone to burning. Now I'm not going to tape off this edge because I'm going to keep the pad slightly tilted away from this edge. And that's why I have these two edges taped off. Looking pretty good. I don't know what's going to show up on that film or not. So I double checked that with my readers, and I wanted to go back because there was still a tiny little bit of line, and I want to, once again, this is where Darren becomes, you know, kind of OCD himself, and I look and I think I can do more. So I sanded it more, went through all my different steps again to see if I could diminish and remove this entirely. Now at this point, I know because of the amount of sanding I've done, this is the point where I want to stop, because when I pull back, I don't have my readers on, I know it's going to be virtually invisible. But with those readers on, I can still see, if I look really closely in the right angle, I can still see that there's still the tiniest of little indentations there. That's acceptable in this moment because, once again, the trade-offs, I've got to accept the limitations that the clear coat is only so thick. That is my limitations, regardless of my skill set. So now I've switched the buffing pads. The backing plate is now a smaller backing plate. This pad, by the way, I just got one from, I think it's called Global Americana. And I wish I could remember the guy's name, but this is his new polish pad. I'm curious as to who actually makes it, because very few people have the means to actually produce their own chemicals and pads. I'm not pushing very hard at all on this. I'm allowing the pad, the machine, and the polish to do its work. Now this polish is just a random polish made by Clear Coat Solutions. It's not available to the public. It's not even what I call professional grade. It's truly commercial grade, which means that it's made for the body shop world, but it is a superior product. So at this point, it will be hologram free. Under normal viewing distances without readers, it will be virtually invisible. So right now, this is the point where I would say, is it perfect? No, it's not perfect. I wanted to achieve perfection, But a perfection is not really doable in this moment without taking that clear coat down so thin that to me that would be inappropriate, especially on the front end of a truck where we know we're going to get more dings and scratches moving forward. So this is what I call the winning balance, especially since I know that under normal viewing distances without magnifiers, you will not be able to see the scratch.
So the customer already taped this off just to mark it because he was going to be gone and his wife is going to be here and wanted to make sure it was marked off as to where exactly the scratch is. So I'm going to just reapply the tape or reposition it. The scratch, I know it's not really going to show up. I realize that. It's from here to there. Very thin through here, a lot deeper through here. Something as a word of caution, after you wet sand, you really, really have to double check your work. And that's why I highly recommend getting those readers. It really will save you a lot of aggravation because you can really scrutinize your work and make sure you remove all the polish and compound, because you will be surprised. And for any beginner, to remove sanding marks requires a lot more pressure if you're using it, or a lot more compound, and I don't mean quantity, but aggressiveness to remove sanding marks than you think. Now that's relative. So some of you may interpret that, and by the way, this is my, the double check 1500 grit sandpaper once again. A lot of you will interpret that differently, and you think like, oh wow, really, I've got to really load up on the product. It's like, well, that's not exactly what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that to remove sanding marks, even though you take it to 3000 grit, you think like, oh, they'll come off so quickly, and they will, trust me, they will, but you need to double check to make sure that they in fact have all been removed. Because as you're working along, you may have removed them 80% or 80% of the area completely, but for some reason you failed to go far enough. So you really have to double check your work, and it's crucial that you do that. And that's really why I love those readers, is because it literally magnifies the area. So I'm going to pay a little more attention to the center of the scratch. I'm applying a little more pressure. And that's the problem with viewer land, is that you can't really tell how much pressure I'm applying. So right now I am applying, I don't know, it's probably less than a pound, put it that way, if you have any way of discerning how much that is or isn't, which is tough out there. And then on the edges, I'm easing up on the pressure, because I know that the edges are far thinner, and my goal is to keep as much of that clear coat intact as possible, but still effectively remove or diminish the scratch as much as what is realistic. Once again, this is a daily driver, it's a truck, they use it to go camping, it's not gonna be the last time they get a scratch on it, there's only so much clear coat you can sand, and so at some point, you end up ringing a bell that can't be unrung. So this is where finessing it and experience comes in. Now you can see the area. It's all scratched up, hazed up, and it still reveals right through here. Right through here, I can still see scratch. So I'm gonna go back through it. Be a little more aggressive here. Do a little more sanding. And as you use the sandpaper, you'll be able to feel the bite to it as to whether it's really biting and doing what it's supposed to be doing versus just gliding over it and not really cutting into the clear coat. You'll be able to feel the difference as you're using it. And I know many of you out there, all you pros, will be like, oh wow, Darren, you hack. You need to use a sanding block. Well, it's, trust me, when I'm done, no one, I don't care how much experience you have, will not be able to tell whether I use the sanding block or not. It will be completely free of any orange peel. Not that this truck has too much orange peel, but it's hard to tell because of the metallic. The metallic flake is so significant on this that it really detracts
the eye. It really camouflages blems, which is, you know, in a large way, the good news. I still see a little scratch area here. Do a little more sanding. Once again, I'm applying a modest amount of pressure relative to wet sanding and how much pressure you use on wet sanding. And I don't see any scratches anymore, so now I'm going to graduate to my 2000 grit. And create a new uniformed scratch pattern. And as a rule, and this is something you have to keep in mind, is that your area that you're working on will increasingly grow. Because what you want to do is you want to blend into the surrounding areas. So let's say I sanded this section here with 1500 grit. Well, now I'm going to go outside the lines and sand a bigger area, a slightly bigger area with 2000 grit, and then 3000 grit, I'm even going to go further out so that it blends. It's just a, and once again, would the customer be able to tell that? No. I could tell if I looked at it, even without glasses, because I can discern with just the naked eye and the right lighting and the right angle, I can tell, you know, within a certain margin of error, what a person sanded the surface with, whether it was 1500 grit, 2000, 3000, there is a way to tell. And that's where experience comes in, because when you see paint work all day long, you see body work all day long, it's kind of like wine tasting. You develop your palate so that it can discern the subtle differences that would be lost on an undeveloped palate. So how about that? With an undeveloped eye, you would not be able to tell the differences. With a developed eye, through years of experience, yes, you could tell, at least when it comes down to that moment. Now, the moment with the sanding block, I would not be able to tell. It would have to be so extreme, and you would have to intentionally try to do that and create a difference, and then maybe I could tell. But for me, I would not be able to tell the difference, not on a section this small. On a big flat panel, maybe that's where you could really, it could reveal itself. Now I'm going to switch to the 3000 grit. And this is where I'm really going to go out, not really, but I'm just going to go outside the boundaries so that it gets blended in. And once again, I'm creating that new scratch pattern of 3000 grit. I'm going to bust out my readers. Going for that final inspection before I bust out my buffer. Now this is where I now reposition this tape, because I sanded all the way up to the tape, and I'm going to just reposition it so that when I polish, I make sure I'm able to polish up completely the sanding area while at the same time protecting this vulnerable fender well trim. I'm actually using Shoal Concepts one-step compound on this. I have other videos. Now because this pad is so big, I can't hold it flat, because if I hold this flat, it's big enough where it would actually rub against this, and it would not get down into this recess. So I actually have to attack this at two angles. Right now it's at a slight tilt, so that right here I'm doing the polishing, and I'm avoiding, even though this is taped off, so this is safe and protected, but I still have to hold it at a slight angle. And then I have to do the same over here and avoid this over here, but still polish this area. So this actually has to be broken down into two sections. Then at the very end, I can do it slightly like this, which would then produce holograms. And then that's where maybe in this case, I'll see how effective I can be with just the rotary and the smaller foam pad. Maybe I will bust out a DA in this moment, we'll see. This paint is pretty forgiving though. It's not like solid black paint, which would be very unforgiving. Whenever you're using the rotary, and it will sometimes happen with the DA, but far less frequently, is you'll get that hop. Because this is spinning on a single axis point, which is part of what makes the rotary more difficult to learn and to use and to be really skilled at it, is that it is just bottom line more difficult in that respect. Yes, you can cut to the chase far quicker, but everything has its trade-offs. And so the trade-off of that is that every time you, because it's spinning and the torque is going, let's see, I think it's clockwise. Actually, it's counter, well, it depends on which way you're holding the buffer. So if it's against this way, it's rotating clockwise, which means if it's going this way, it's going to want to push the buffer the opposite way. So every time you switch panels, and based on the character lines and the nuances of the panel, it will grab in different areas. And so until you can figure out exactly how you have to position the buffer and what area of that buffer you need to be using in order for it to stay steady, that is normal for even a guy like me that has plenty of experience, because you just have to familiarize with the geography of the surface you're working on. Now, something I noticed, and this is what's difficult about doing this type of work for people that are that critical with their eye, is that, for example, I'm working here and I'm hyper-focused on this area, but then I look over to the left and I see this nice, let's see if we can see it. I look over here and I see this nice long scratch that goes all the way down here. So it's like, okay, what do we do with that? If he wanted this removed, why would he not want this removed? So that's where you have to have a conversation with the customer. And if you quoted a certain price to do certain things, and now they want to add this in, it's like, okay, well, what's that going to be worth now? So this is where I have to go in and have a conversation. Looks like we are in for some more fun. So I pulled the customer out here, and sure enough, they want it gone. Big shocker, right? So simply, I will repeat my steps. The scratch goes right through the middle there. And the only tricky part of this, I mean, this, if you had to have a scratch, this is the place to have it. It's a nice big flat panel. But right here at the end, there is a character line that indents. So this will be the kind of the booby trap, waiting for you to sand too aggressively or polish, but I need to take it all the way to that edge in order for complete removal. So you just, once again, respond accordingly and appropriately. Like I said, as you are sanding, you can feel as to whether the sandpaper is really cutting into the paint or not. Once it starts getting, as it wears down, it becomes smoother, and you know that it's not really doing much damage in a good way, the kind of damage you want it to do, which is sanding that surface, sanding down to essentially the bottom of that scratch. I did the fingernail check. It is what I consider a pretty superficial scratch, which is the good news. But nonetheless, I could still catch a slight edge to it. And now, and I've got my readers on, I can still see that there's some scratch right through here. By doing this, it will reveal nuances to the scratch that will not be seen before you start. It just creates a different backdrop to it. and a different effect, and it creates a different type of contrast between the surrounding areas and the scratch itself. And also, once again, this scratch is so thin, you know, if you think you're gonna go get some touch-up paint and apply it over this scratch, I promise you it will be a worse problem. You will not like the trade-off, because it will be touch-up paint that is literally laying on top of a very flat surface, and it will create its own shadow, and therefore it's like trading off one problem for another. Now I will segue to my 2000 grit. And you do have to be careful doing what I'm doing, because I have not soaked this paper in water. And really, when you soak in water, it doesn't really loosen it up that much, in my opinion. Of course, like everything else, not all sandpapers are created equal. So you'll have people that will literally soak their sandpaper overnight in the water. And I get it, it makes sense, and it will be a little easier to work with. But there's always workarounds to cut to the chase, and this is one of them. So I'm having to be cautious, because the edges of the sandpaper, the folds, that type of stuff, you can't tell, and it would appear that I'm not being cautious with respect to those elements, when in fact I am. You just don't know it. So unless I call it out, as I'm doing now, you really don't know what's going on. You don't know how much pressure, and that's what's difficult about video. Yes, a picture's worth 1,000 words, maybe a video's worth, I don't know, 1,000,000 words, whatever, but it's still not everything. But trust me, guys, you are so much further ahead of the curve because you have access to YouTube. I, on the other hand, had to learn through firsthand experience. At least you guys have a starting point. At least you have someone like me that can kind of at least talk you through the big landmines, if you will. Now I come in with the 3000 grit. And these discs are really nice to use. Very friendly, certainly friendlier than the paper. And as you can tell, my scratch pattern and my area that I'm working grows increasingly bigger and bigger, because I'm blending in the scratch area to the surrounding areas. Now I'm gonna wipe. Double check with my readers. Look for any discernible scratch that's remaining. Looks like right through here. And you really have to look closely, even with readers on, right through here. Because once I polish this, it actually will, in some ways, enhance a scratch. If you haven't removed it 100%, it will literally enhance it, because you've created such a perfected canvas that now any blem whatsoever is truly going to reveal itself. It's kind of the irony of that moment. And that's what, if you're doing paint correction work, that's a disclaimer that I give to my customers, is that it will reveal stuff. If I do paint correction, but it's not paint correction to the point where I'm trying to like create a flawless canvas, I know that it's going to reveal certain blemishes in the paint that were not there before, because they were disguised by the dirt, the orange peel, go down the list. And then suddenly you do this high level paint correction and stuff is revealed, and it can be disturbing sometimes. There's the amount of polish that I'm putting on right now. Really, I don't need this tape. This is just gonna get in my way at this point. I don't need to protect those areas. And I'm not even gonna tape off this area here, because I know that I can finesse it without burning the edge. as I said before, at this point, I want to make sure to double check my work. I can only assume that all the sanding marks have been polished out, but I don't want to put everything away and then look at it at a different angle or different lighting, have a rude awakening, and still see some scratch. So I'm going to check here, because that was the area that was more vulnerable. And I know the scratch went through here. And we have 100% removal as far as I can tell. And I'm doing everything I can to basically critique my own work. Essentially, as I tell my worker bees, whoever they may be, because this is where we lose the ability to be objective about ourselves, is because we just did something, in our head, we think, in fact, we are certain that we have achieved perfection, whether it's bug removal or applying wax, taking wax off, because we just did it, we suddenly or instantly lose objectivity. So in order to play a mind game and try to deceive the ego, because the ego is going to tell you that you got it, Darren, you nailed it, it's fine, you're good, you went through all the proper steps, you're good to go. The ego will tell you that. So what you have to do is trick the ego. So I play this little mind game, and I do it with my employees whenever I teach them. They'll come back and say, okay, Darren, I'm done, I took off the wax. I said, okay, did you double check your work? Yeah, I did. I said, oh, so if I went and found some wax, would that be surprising to you? Well, yeah, because I just double checked it. I know that I got it. And I said, well, okay, we could play one of two games here. The first game is pretend that you have a coworker that you hate and you want to get his ass fired. So you want to go around, you want to scrutinize his work to the boss and show to the boss how bad of a worker he is. So you're going to go around and I promise you, you will be able to find something he missed. So now pretend that that co-worker of yours that you hate so vehemently just took the wax off, and I just had a conversation with them, and now you go in and you find his mistake. I promise you, you will come back and you will tell me, yes, in fact, Darren, I did find some wax. It's like, well, you told me you took it off and you also told me you double checked it. Why suddenly in the third attempt, when you changed or you altered your perception or your lenses in which you view the world, why suddenly were you able to find a mistake? That's because the ego clouds the judgment and it clouds your ability for objectivity. So the other game I play is, for example, when my children say, oh, I can't. It's like, okay, can't to me just means you won't. Can't may sound like a good excuse, but what's the real excuse? Because there's a good reason and then there's the real reason. I don't want excuses. I just want it done. If they truly cannot do it, that's a different conversation. So the game I play with them is say, okay, daughter, loving daughter of mine that I love so dearly, tell you what, I promise you that if I attached a $100 bill to this moment and I said, Holland, you go figure out, and by the way, that's not just a name of a country or a province of a country, that is the name of my middle daughter. So I say, Holland, I promise you that if you go, and I said that if you figure it out, I will pay you $100. I know she will be able to figure it out because I have just incentivized her by the $100 bill. But by default, we're lazy, narcissistic creatures. So we've got to constantly fight through the ego. And very few things in life will require as much discipline and patience as detailing, because it is, after all, about the details. It's not called generalizing or generaling. Thank you, Steve Vandervoorst of Belgium. He threw that one out to me, which I thought was very appropriate. And after all, it's not called generalizing. It is, in fact, called detailing. So if you're going to get the details right, you've got to learn, if you're by yourself or you're training employees, how to teach them that discipline and that awareness. Because we do not slide out of the womb naturally with this developed sense of awareness, never mind self-awareness, objectivity, discipline, tenacity, patience, diligence, all those things. You have to develop them like everything else in life, whether it's your body, your mind, your soul, not to get all, you know, I don't know what you want to call it, psychobabble on you, but I'm just trying to illustrate a point, and these are strategies that I use myself because I've trained so many guys, I've had to figure it out. It's like, man, I'm tired of these guys coming back saying, yeah, Darren, I checked it, it's good, man, we're golden. No, we're not golden. You know why? Because I'm going to come in and I'm going to find something that you missed. So I get it, they're not the business owner. There's not as much, you know, stewardship, responsibility, accountability as being an employee versus an owner. So I get that part. I'm not unreasonable. Trust me, I'm not. But I also know if they're going to last, they've got to be able to perform. I don't want to keep, it's like, let's go biblical on you for a moment. Give a man a fish and you feed him for a day, teach him how to fish, you feed him for a lifetime. And I apply that same principle. That's a universal principle in my opinion. So I want to teach them how to essentially self-correct, how to work through the self-deception that the ego will automatically apply in every moment of life. And by the way, those are lessons that you can take anywhere in your life. It doesn't just apply to detailing. I'm just using detailing as my moment of opportunity to teach you guys something. So here we have perfection. And oh, do I love the feel of silky, smooth paint that's been decontaminated and polished, and it's just like waxed glass. I mean, nothing, very few things in life feel better than this to the senses, as in the touch. That's me, okay, had a little moment. Maybe I need a little moment to myself, but I think you get it. Due to the fact that this is a very exposed panel, a rather large area, and it is darker paint, I am going to now finish it because I know that there, and I checked, I can see subtle holograms. And subtle is the key word. I do mean subtle. But I don't want subtle. I want nothing, as in none, as in no holograms whatsoever. Now, as a rule, and by the way, this is a single battery, and it's still, just to give you some context, it's got four bars that will show you the charge. You press this little button, 10, and three bars are still showing up. I started with a full capacity charge on this battery, and it still has three bars left. It's got plenty of torque. I cannot stall this machine, which means I cannot push it hard enough against something in order to force it not to move. So it's got plenty of torque, plenty of power. Like I said, the only limitation of this is the battery life, but like I said, everything has that limitation when it comes to battery operated anything. With the two batteries, I've got one charging up right now. I didn't think I'd need it, but just in case, I like to be prepared. Also, when I'm removing wet sanding marks, as a rule, I will keep the buffer speed between 12 to 1500 RPMs. When I switch to a foam pad, I will dial it down between 1000 to 1200 RPMs. I will start out with heavy pressure and back off, whether I'm using a wool pad or a foam cutting pad or a foam finishing pad. Now I know that this is a foam, what's considered a foam cutting pad, which personally, it's gotta be the softest foam cutting pad I've ever used. But this is, I think it's, like I said, it's, I know it is, I just can't remember the name, if it's either Global Americana or Americana Global. So far, I've used the pad about four times, seems to be holding up. It's got all these holes that are supposed to allow it to cool.
And it seems to be a very good pad so far. Now, if this was black paint, I would dial this down to 800 RPMs, and I would really just take my time and work those holograms out. But these products that I'm using are just that good. It allows me to be a better detailer, a quicker detailer, more efficient, more profitable. Call it or label it however works in your brain. Now I'm gonna shoot some wax on this. We'll be good as golden, baby. Good as golden. Whatever the hell that means. Oh yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Now it's been waxed. Oh yes. Yes, folks, I'm having a moment with my canvas, my truck that's not really mine. It's just my work of art now. And yes, I am proud of my work of art. I'm not gonna lie. So there we go, different angles. 100% removal of that scratch, 100% removal of that scratch, and what I would call 99% removal of this scratch. But even standing here, I seriously cannot see anything. So for many people, I mean, I just have to look in the right lighting to try to catch a subtlety of the original scratch, but it's just so hard to pick up. So in my opinion, I'm gonna call that success. And I hope you guys have learned something along the way.